If you'll just make the decision, the Holy Ghost will make the revolution. He'll turn it around. I want everybody that will to stand. I want you to sing that.
Crucified again. Am I causing him pain? Hallelujah.
Thank you. You may be seated. We cry holy to the Lord. Amen. We cry holy, holy, holy. Lord God Almighty. That's what we're going to be doing for eternity. So we might as well get an early start. What a beautiful congregation. I believe God is doing great things today. Next Sunday, we will have child dedication. If you are interested in that, then Lisa and I need to hear from you this week so we can have a sit down and talk about that. We want to hear from everybody that maybe you've seen a change, a transformation in your life, whether it's today or this week. We want to hear from you. We don't always know what God is doing, but I do believe that God's working throughout this service and throughout this congregation. You know, the Holy Spirit is a gentleman. I know the Holy Spirit when I see it. Miss Lisa? I know the Holy Ghost when I see it. I say, I know the Holy Ghost when I see it. Somebody give God praise. I believe in the resurrection power. I want to talk to you this morning about that resurrection power. I want to talk to you because this is Resurrection Sunday. Actually, every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. Amen? That's why we worship on Sunday. People say, y'all worship on the Sabbath. Well, Jesus is our Sabbath. Every day is a Sabbath. But Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. We celebrate that we serve a risen Savior.
Yes.
Amen? And we can celebrate Him today. If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn with me to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 4. I want to read three verses of Scripture today that God has laid upon my heart. I believe that He is going to speak powerful truth right out of His Word. Amen?
Yes. Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. I want to talk about plugging to the power of the resurrection. It might be a simple illustration that you see, but you know, you can have all the electricity in the world, and you can have all the power you need coming to your home, but if you don't plug in your appliance, you're going to have to get out the hand can opener. See, you can't use an electrical appliance without electricity. God wants the church to understand that He's got us here not to sit in a drawer and go unused. He wants to use the church. But for the church to be used sufficiently, for the church to be used adequately, we need to plug into the power of the Holy Spirit. We need to let go and let God. Everybody doesn't have to dance the same. Brother Pastor TJ said, free people can't sit still. Well, fat people can't dance. So there's somewhere in between. Amen? Somewhere in between. You're right. Free people can't sit still. I'm right too. But I'm here to tell you, the Holy Spirit will cause you to do things you've never done.
Yes.
So He can use you in ways you've never been used.
Excellent.
And I want to go to Acts chapter 4 and verse 31, where it says, and when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. Now the multitude of those who believed were of one heart, one soul. Did you hear that? The multitude had unity. That's a miracle. That is a miracle within itself. The multitude who believed were one heart, one soul. Neither did anyone say that any of the things he possessed was his own. But they had all things in common. And with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. Listen, and great grace was upon them all. This is what Brother Rick was talking about, that grace that comes upon us. How many of you feel that grace here today?
Yes, yes.
Now, I love to read about the New Testament church. I love to read, and I'm sorry, I moved my mic. I love to read about the New Testament church, and I love to read where 3,000 souls were saved in one day.
Amen.
I'll read another place where 5,000 souls were saved in one day. Acts chapter 2 and verse 47 says this, praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. I love to think about that kind of church growth. I love to think about where daily people's lives are being changed and where there are miracles taking place, where there's life-altering experiences going on in the lives of people, where divine healings are taking place and demons are being released, all of it in the name of Jesus. People are being freed from the torment, freed from the addictions. This is what we're all about, is for people to experience the move of the Holy Spirit and to put their trust in Jesus Christ. And so when I read about the early church, I think that great things happen, and we can see that again in John chapter 21, verse 25. He said, and there are also many other things that Jesus did, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. That's a lot of activity. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
What an exciting time this must have been. What an exciting season. I would love to have been there, and I love to study about it. Many of us think and believe that there can be a return of this power. Many of us believe that there can be a resurrection power within the body of Christ. Many of us long for revival of this kind of season. We rely on the fact that Hebrews 13 and 8 declares concerning Jesus that He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We stand on the scripture such as Joel 2 and 28, where it says, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. I lean on a scripture that says, greater things than these shall you do, for I go to my Father which is in heaven. I hear what he says in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 19 through 21. I'm so excited about this verse this morning, I can hardly stand it. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe? According to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead. There's Easter. There's the resurrection, and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. I'll lean on that verse because it lets me know that what happened in the New Testament church can happen today. That what happened in the New Covenant, what happened in the New Testament era of time can happen today. That what happened to the woman with the issue of blood, it can happen today. That what happened to those who were healed with blinded eyes and those who were lame and those that could not speak. I think about a man lowered down from the roof of a church and God's about to heal him. I can tell you and I declare that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Do not misunderstand the heart of this pastor. I'm looking for those things to happen again. I'm looking for a New Testament. I'm looking for a first century church in a 21st century time. Let's be real. We're not seeing what we should see. We must have the same power that they have in the New Covenant, they have the New Testament, rather. We should have the same power. We must have it, because that's the only way we're going to fulfill the mandate. For us to go around the world, he said in Mark 16 and verse 14, later he appeared to the 11 as they sat at the table. He rebuked their unbelief and hardness of heart because they did not believe those who had seen him after he had risen. What we believe is important.
Yes, it is.
He was reprimanding the apostles. And he said to them, go into all the world and preach this gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. But he who does not believe will be condemned. How many think it's important that we believe?
Amen.
And these signs will follow those who believe in my name. They will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover.
Yes, they will.
I hear the same loving rebuke today upon the church that Jesus gave the apostles. I hear the same loving rebuke that he gave to the 11 that we hear concerning their unbelief and their apathy and their distractions and their worldliness. I hear the same warning from the Lord today. There's too much of the world in the church.
Yes, amen.
There's too much apathy in the church.
Yes.
There's too much distraction in the church. There's too much performance in the church. There's too much entertainment in the church. God will pour out His Spirit in these last days if we will meet the requirements, if we will pay the price, if we will walk according to His Word. We're not going to accidentally see a revival of New Testament miracles. It's going to come because we are intentional.
Yes.
Do you know you can be intentional and still miss the mark? You can be intentional and still come up short. There's some things that we must do. For the sake of this message and this sermon, I'm going to tell you there's some things we must plug into.
Right.
We've got to plug into some things. Yeah. And that starts with you. Everybody say, that starts with me.
Starts with me.
It's not corporate unless it is first individual.
Amen.
And by the way, you can come in here and feel good and still not plug in.
Right.
I say this lovingly when I tell you that all of this is great and we love it and we rejoice in His grace. And this is no small thing. But the decision that you've got to make today, am I going to plug into Jesus?
Right.
Am I going to plug into the power of the Holy Spirit? We've got to plug into the power of prayer.
Yeah.
We've got to plug into the power of prayer. It's right in our text. In our text, chapter 4, verse 31. And when they had prayed. Amen. It didn't say when they had played.
Right.
It didn't say when they gathered together. It didn't say when they fellowshipped and had a dinner on the ground. It said when they prayed.
Yes.
When they prayed, the place was shaken and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. When the disciples came back from the meeting with the Sanhedrin, they all came together in prayer. They didn't come together and start talking about it. We don't see it here. They didn't come together and start talking about how mean that one was and how ugly this was and what so and so did. In other words, they didn't have themselves a little gossip session. They took it to the Lord in prayer. Amen. They might not have liked everything that was going on, but they took it to the Lord. Just like Hannah that we studied Wednesday night. When she saw the problem, the Bible says she took it straight to God. Somebody say straight. When you get tempted, when you're struggling in your emotions, when you're struggling in your spirit, take it to the Lord in prayer. Don't hesitate to go straight to God. They prayed together in one mind. It's hard for people to pray together in one mind when they don't like each other.
That's
The Spirit of God moved upon them with great power. Why? Because God honors the prayers of His people. When we come together as one with a common goal, God will honor you with His presence.
Yes, amen.
When we get our eyes off of the world, when we get our eyes off of other people, when we stop judging everyone and critiquing everyone and trying to straighten out everyone, I'm going to turn around so you don't look so mean at me. But when we try to quit straightening out everybody else's business, and we start praying. Honey, their business is not in your jurisdiction. Amen. You don't have the authority or the ability to straighten out. The Holy Ghost will straighten out what He must straighten out. Amen. We spend too much time in the church world trying to clean up the neighbor's yard when we're tripping over our own trash.
Good word. Yes.
James 5:16 says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another, that you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. We must have a renewed understanding of the importance of prayer. We must plug into the power of biblical prayer, led by the Spirit, fed by the Spirit, filled with the Holy Ghost. We must pray according to the Word of God. We must pray according to the Holy Spirit. We shouldn't pray amiss, and we shouldn't halfway pray. We need to plug into the power of prayer.
Yes, amen.
He said in Matthew 7:7, and it shall be given you, seek, and you shall find, knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth, and he that seeketh, findeth, and to him that knocketh, it shall be open. I love that verse in Jeremiah where he said, call unto me.
Yes. Yes. Hallelujah.
And I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. You might like to just hang out here for a moment.
All right.
See, there's a lot I don't know. But if I call out to God in prayer, and if I meet His prayer requirements, His prayer prerequisitions or requirements, if I will meet the Lord and I will get my ducks in a row and get in alignment with the Holy Ghost and get my eyes off of people, and if I will get in alignment with God and pray, it's not about volume. Hannah, when she prayed, she wasn't praying loud. The Bible says that the priest just saw her lips move.
That's right.
It's not about impressing God. And by the way, it's not about volume, but if you want to scream and pray and seek God that way, that's great too.
Right.
It's not about being loud. It's not about being quiet. It's about being sincere.
Amen.
And so we pray and we call unto the Lord. He said in John 14:13, He said, and whatever you ask in my name, I will do it. The Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. The Word of God cannot lie. I said the Word of God cannot lie. Y'all might not believe what I'm about to tell you, but twice in my life, I've had someone to my face tell me that God was a liar. Whew, that's a dangerous thing to say. First of all, the Bible says that God is not a man that he should lie. Secondly, you need to be careful about blaspheming God. You need to, well, I've had two people in my ministry tell me, I asked God in Jesus' name and he didn't do it, and he's a liar. Now, I'm going to tell you what he is. He's a merciful God.
Yes, he is.
But he's also a God of judgment.
Yes.
And he's also a God who loves you and cares about you. But we have to put our faith in God. The Word of God cannot lie. God did not lie then, and he does not lie today. Can you say amen?
Amen.
He said, now this is the confidence that you have in him. Amen?
Yes.
He said that we have in him that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us.
Yes.
I know it's not up there for you to see, but let me just tell you something. There it is. Maybe you can see it. I gotta stop here. Maybe the reason you're not getting answered, maybe the reason we're not getting prayer answered, is we're not praying according to God's will. Amen. He says right there, if we ask anything, he will hear us. That's not what it says. Now, he said, if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Father, not my will, but thy will be done. What is your will? He would that men everywhere lift up his name and praise him. He would, his will is that he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. We need to understand it's God's will for us to plug into the power of the Holy Ghost and to the power of prayer and pray according to his will. Luke chapter 11 verses 1 through 5. Now it came to pass as he was praying in a certain place, he sees one of his disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. And he said, when you pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, the kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us day by day our daily bread, this is in Luke, and forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. You know, the Bible says that if you don't forgive, you'll not be forgiven. There's a lot of people in my ministry have asked me that question. What does it mean to forgive? How do you forgive someone? Well, listen, it's really simple. It's just not easy.
Come on. Amen.
That's right. Simple and easy, two different things. It's simple, you got to forgive others. And I don't mean partially, I don't mean 80%, I mean completely. You've got to let it go. By the way, that's what forgive means in the Greek. It means let it go. Well, Pastor, I can't let it go. They hurt me too bad. You pray according to God's will. You forgive them. And you pray, God will answer prayer. You'll move on beyond anything. You'll move to the next level. God will bless you. God will begin to move in your life. If you and I will plug into the power of prayer. He said, when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites. Moving on, he said, when you pray, do not use vain repetition. There's a lot more, but I'm going to move on. 1 Thessalonians 5 and 17. He says, pray without ceasing. Pastor, you act like we ought to just pray all the time. Well, when you plug something into the receptacle, is the electricity there all the time?
It is.
Listen, it is. Unless you got a breaker that's been broke. Unless you got a community problem like we had last Sunday morning when we didn't have lights in the house. When the electricity's on the house, you can plug it in and unplug it. Plug it in and unplug it. It's there all the time. And the Lord says, pray without ceasing. Plug into the power of prayer. I know you can close your eyes and drive at the same time. I hope you don't. But honey, I learned a long time ago when I was just a young man, I learned to pray with my eyes open. You don't have to agree with that. I'm just here to tell you, I pray with my eyes open a lot of times. I pray going down the road. You can pray going down the road. You can pray while you're working. You can pray instead of fussing. You can pray instead of gossiping.
Yes.
You can pray instead of sinning. Mm-hmm. You can pray instead of watching Netflix.
Amen.
You can pray instead of watching and listening and doing things that you ought not. He said, pray without ceasing. He said in Luke 18 and 1, then he spoke a parable to them that men always ought to pray.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Ephesians chapter 6 says, pray always with all prayer and supplication. In the Spirit, being watchful to this end, with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. This is what I get from this verse. You can't watch if you're not praying in the Spirit. You know why? Because you're not going to see what you need to see. Sometimes, when I'm looking for something, and my wife will testify to this probably more than I want. I went in the closet yesterday, and I was looking for something. I went in the closet a second time, looking for something. I went to this place. Have you seen it? It's in your closet. So I went in the closet and I didn't see it. And the fourth time when I turned, there it was, right in front of me. See, when you're not walking in the Spirit, you're not going to see what you need to see. When you're not praying in the Spirit, you're not going to have the eagle eyes that you need. You're not going to have that discernment that you need. God will show you things when you and I plug into the power of prayer. He will show us things that we can build up ourselves in our most holy faith. Praying in the Holy Ghost according to Jude. Keep yourselves in the love of God. How am I supposed to keep myself in the love of God? By plugging into the power of prayer.
Yes, amen. Hallelujah.
1 Timothy 4:7. But refuse profane and old wives' fables, and exercise thyself rather unto godliness. In Acts 24:16, and herein do I exercise myself, to have always a conscious void of offense toward God and toward men. I'm going to challenge somebody here this morning. I want you to pray more this week than you've ever prayed. You come back next week and tell me the difference between your weeks. I challenge you, just like Pastor TJ challenged us a while ago. I'll give you a challenge. You pray more this week than you've ever prayed, and you come back next week and you tell me how God didn't move. You tell me what God didn't show you. You tell me how you can't seem to feel better about the circumstance. It won't be that way. I challenge you, I challenge everybody to plug into the power of prayer. I wonder, someone sitting here today, how long has it been since you really prayed? I was sitting in Kelly's kitchen this week. And across, right next to me, was a little family. And there was a little boy who was maybe 5. And he wouldn't let his family touch the food until they prayed. There were 6 of them. There was actually 2 tables. When he got everybody's attention, he bowed that sweet little head and he prayed, God is great, God is good. And I believe in that. But some of y'all need to pray. Some of y'all need to go home and close the door and pray. Get in your closet and pray. And pray through the slot, the time slot of your favorite program. Pray until you have prayed through. Pray for an hour or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. Pray like those Uganda precious people pray. Walk up to the mountain and pray all night. You pray. You plug into the power of prayer. You come next Sunday, and it might be you shot all over this place.
Amen.
Second thing we got to plug into is the power of love. I got more preaching than I'm going to get done today, but I'm going to tell you, if the church wants to be a New Testament church, we've got to plug into the power of prayer, and we've got to plug into the power of love. We've got to love each other once again. People say, well, we've got to love the world. Now listen closely. How are you going to love the world if you can't love each other? Some people say they love the world, and I'm saying this with love. But some people, when they say they love the world, they lie. They don't love people. I'm telling you, a racist doesn't love people. A racist is somebody that doesn't love somebody. You can figure it out in your mind and convince yourself that it's all right. But I'm here to tell you we need to plug into the power of love in the body of Christ. He said when the multitude in the second part of this text when the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and one soul, neither did anyone say that any of the things he possessed was his own. They had all things in common. They loved each other. They were serious about investing in one another, embracing one another. The church is not attractive to the world when we can't even get along. The church is not attractive to the world when we split up and we split up and we split up and we've got more empty churches than we've ever had before. That's the best preaching you've heard all morning. When I tell you the world looks at the two cars that are in the parking lot on Sunday morning and they realize that people can't even get along enough to go to church together. Why would I want to be a part of a church that don't love each other? We need to plug into the power of love. We got a loving church, and I can say that without any hesitation. But we need to plug into the power of love. John 17 and verse 21, that they all may be one. This was the prayer that Jesus had. He said that they may be one as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they may also be one. We should have unity. And he said, why do I want them to be one? That the world may believe that you sent me.
Right.
How many of you believe that God sent his son?
Yes.
How many of you believe for God so loved the world that he gave?
Yes.
See, that's how you convert it. That's how you transform, is by believing. See, we get hung up on all these. Some things are secondary, folks. Some things are not eternal issues.
Right.
But we get all hung up on our denominational distinctives. We get all hung up on little things that really don't matter. I'm telling you that if we'll plug into the power of prayer and if we'll plug into the power of love, a lot of those things that we get hung up on are going to work themselves out. We just give it to God in prayer, and a lot of the things that we fuss about sometimes in the body of Christ, it don't even matter to God. Why are we fussing about something that God don't care about? He goes to Corinthians, and I'm going to move on. But he says, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not love, I'm going to move on to the third thing that we must plug into. I first called this, we must plug into the power of preaching. But I didn't want to lose anybody. But I am going to tell you something. Everybody is not called the pastor. Everybody is not called to be an apostle or a prophet or even a teacher or an evangelist. But everybody is called to preach.
Amen.
Amen. You know, I'm telling you, preachers watching me on Facebook, they're squirming right now. So I got preachers in the house that are squirming right now. Now, Pastor, everybody's not called to preach. He said, compel them to come in. That's why I changed the word to witness. You look back at our text and you will find in Acts chapter 34, chapter 4, verse 33, this is what he says. He says, with great power gave the apostles. With great power the apostles gave witness to the resurrection. I'm telling you, I just wish I was there. I wish I could have been there. I've been in some powerful services, Brother Joe. I've seen some preachers lose their everlasting mind. I've seen people shout like Sister Lisa did this morning. I've seen preachers get up and absolutely lose it. The power of the Holy Ghost hit them and them preach under some. But I would have liked to have been there that day when the apostles gave witness with great power. And that's the kind of power that we need to plug into. I love what somebody said this morning already. When was the last time you just witnessed to somebody? When was the last time you just went to somebody and told them about, you know what witness is? Witness is when you tell what happened to you. And you start with that. I said, you start with that. You can tell them about Grandma if you want to. You can tell them about Brother Joe, Brother Larry. You can tell them about, ooh, some of y'all are going to leave here today. They're going to go this week. They're going to say, oh, you should have seen that, Lisa, and I am this week. The Holy Ghost came on her, and she got to thanking God for what He'd done in her life. I was reading her mind. Lord, thank you for setting me free from all the junk you set me free from. All of this and that and where I've been. And you can begin to tell people, I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. We need to plug into the power of a witness. People don't care how big you shout until they know your life. I'm telling you, Brother Jerry and Sister Michelle up here, I'm just telling you, they can get up here and say whatever they want. As far as Ron Johnson's concerned, they can get up here and preach and say, I'm not even to set him on fire. But I'm here to tell you, when I know what God brought about. Folks, I don't know what else happened in this altar this morning, but I'm here to tell you, Jesus will set you free. Jesus will give you a high you never had. The Holy Ghost will take you to places you've never gone. He'll give you glory and victory like you've never known. I'm a witness. During the night last night, sometimes God waits about 3:00 on Sunday morning to give me one more little nugget. Woo! I woke up this morning. I don't know if I woke Sister Lisa up. But I woke up and I said it out loud. God's got a witness protection program. Woo! He'll change your name. He'll change your life. He'll set your feet on the ground. He'll put you in a new place. And He will protect you as a witness of Jesus Christ. If you're a witness, I want you to stand and give Him praise.
Sent me, draws me.
and I will raise him up at the last day. That makes me want to preach on resurrection. I'm here to tell you, when you're in Jesus and you die, that body goes in the grave, but on that great getting up morning, that resurrection morning, your spirit, your soul are going to be reunited, not with the old body, with a brand new body. I'm here to tell you, it's a perfect body, and He's going to raise you up. He's going to raise you up. Plug it to the power of prayer. Plug it to the power of love. Plug it to the power of witness. God will change your life and change your purpose. When people see you coming, they might see an addict coming right now. You get Jesus, oh, they're going to change. Oh, Lord, here comes so-and-so. Anybody ever met one of these people? Here they come. They're going to talk about Jesus. Here they come. Oh, Lord, let's get out of here. Hurry, let's get out of here. They're going to preach to me. They're going to witness to me. They're going to love me. They're going to pray for me. Everybody, I'm going to ask you a question. Would you just plug in today? Would you just plug into the power of prayer? Would you just plug in to the power of love? Get on her nerves so bad. She told me one time when I was young, I wanted to eat you up. I wish I had. I knew what she said. In a moment of anger, you might say something. In a moment of anger, you might feel something towards somebody. But you know what you do? You plug it up. I got to go preaching. It's like a vacuum cleaner. Yeah. That vacuum cleaner, when you see the dirt, go plug it up. When you see the mess, go plug it up. Plug it up and go to vacuum it. Don't wait for somebody else to get it. Don't wait for somebody else to feel the effects of it. I'm here to tell you, plug into the power of prayer. Plug into the power of love. Plug in. Keep going. Pastor, I'm not far enough in this journey to be a witness. Honey, you got it all wrong. Jerry said it perfect this morning. We're not a bunch of perfect people. But we plugged in and we tried. I'm here to tell you, wherever you are at on the journey, somebody might go home and tell a family member today, I really don't know what happened this morning. But it sure did feel good. Do you know this world is spending billions and trillions of dollars trying to feel what we have felt in the last hour? If you're here today, I want to challenge you. Listen, I want everybody to bow your head. If you're here today and you're lost, I want to give you the invitation to come and to pray and to present yourself before God and to repent of your sin and turn from your ways. This could be the greatest day of your life. Yes, anybody just wanted to step out and come and pray on this Easter Sunday? Anybody? Anybody want to raise your hand? No one's looking around. Anybody want to raise your hand and say, Pastor, I'm not where I need to be with God. I want you to pray for me because I'm going to get this thing turned around. Raise your hand. Pastor TJ, I want you to come get these. Fill the Holy Ghost. Raise your hand again. Pastor TJ is going to hand you some information. Raise your hand again so I can see who you are. No one's looking around. Everyone pray. Please, everyone pray. We got hands all over the house. Pastor, I'm not where I need to be with God. I want to draw closer. I want to get closer to God. I want to rededicate my life. Whatever it is that's in your heart, I need to know. I need some direction. I need some guidance. Father, thank you for every heart that's here, for every hand that was raised. have your way. Sister Barbara, I feel like asking you to come and pray over this service. I'm going to go to the front door, but I felt specifically pray us right now.
Will we have service tonight, Pastor?
No, service begins the Sunday night after Easter. So that's next Sunday night, and we'll get you more information on that as we can. Is this thing on?
Will the youth have service?
Youth will have service tonight. No youth. Everybody say no youth service.
No youth service tonight.
Be with your family. This is Easter. I want you to pray with Sister Barbara. I feel the Holy Spirit has directed her. I feel like she's going to pray an important prayer.
Father, we're so thankful today. God, we're so thankful for this service, for your presence, and for your anointing in this place today. And we don't need an Easter Sunday to celebrate resurrection, but we can have a resurrection every day. Because you said, you are the resurrection and the life. And in you we live and move and have our being. Father, we thank you for the people that's present here this morning, for those that you spoke to their hearts, that you touched their lives. I pray that they would go on to follow you and to know you and the power of your resurrection. And in your word and in your long suffering and in your glory, Lord, that they would know you in a way that they've never known you before. Father, we bless this people and the congregation as we go our way. We thank you again for this service, for our pastors, for our leadership, for our people. We pray for this service. We thank you, Lord. We praise you. We praise you that you would go before us the rest of this day and the rest of this week to declare